start off with a word of prayer, and then we'll have Brother Evan come up and eventually. Don't forget, just a quick announcement, as Brother Evan's coming on up right now. Senior adults tomorrow, I know he's going to mention it, but senior adults tomorrow, 11:30, and here at the fellowship.
All right, well, good evening, New Hope Baptist Church. I know it's cold outside, I know you've had a long day. I know a lot of you did not get an afternoon nap, but guys, good evening. Thank you. I don't get a whole lot of human interaction anymore, so just kidding. Anyways, moving on. All right, couple announcements for y'all tonight. We had 43 present in our discipleship training classes, three of those being visitors. And of course, as Brother Tim mentioned, tomorrow morning at 11:30, we will have a senior adult covered dish lunch and bingo over in the fellowship hall. Basketball for the Children's League does resume tomorrow night, 5:45, 6:30, and then 7:15. It's going to be a great time. That is 50 cents for you to get through the door. Unless you are a player, then you get in for absolutely free. And then, of course, this upcoming Friday, we do have D-Now starting at 5 p.m. on Friday night. That's going to be in the old fellowship hall in the gymnasium. Registration will start there, and we'll go all the way until Sunday morning during the morning worship service. It's going to be a really special weekend. Please be in prayer for our students and the adults and parents and chaperones and band and speaker and all of them who will be interacting with our students. Pray that, number one, pray for the salvation of their souls. Pray that God would speak to them in a very clear way regarding their relationship with Him. Pray for our speaker that he would communicate God's word effectively and accurately. Pray for the band as all of them travel and as they lead us in worship. Pray for their hearts and pray for your volunteers as well, because I have a feeling about that Saturday night about 10 o'clock, we're going to be ready for kids to go to sleep. Okay, so y'all just pray for this weekend. Stay down. And I do have supply lists right there on the front pew. If anybody needs one, I have a supply list for you. Tonight, and of course the rest of the stuff you can see in the bulletin. Don't want to take up too much time with announcements tonight, but I do like to read a passage of scripture to you coming out of Matthew chapter 12 starting in verse 33. And Jesus says, "Either make the tree good and its fruit good, or make the tree bad and its fruit bad. For the tree is known by its fruit. You brood of vipers, how can you speak good when you are evil? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. The good person out of his good treasure brings forth good, and the evil person out of his evil treasure brings forth evil. I tell you, on the day of judgment, people will give account for every careless word they speak. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned." Of course, Jesus is speaking to Pharisees when he says these words. Context is that the Pharisees are supposed to be these really righteous and holy religious leaders, but by their words and their actions, they were leading people even further away from God. And I think the context, the application to us as 21st century believers is that if you are in Christ, you are made holy by Christ. If you are outside of Christ, then you are not holy. And that you need to become good. Be good by knowing Jesus as Lord and Savior, by allowing Him to change and transform our hearts and our lives, forgive us of our sin, and that's how we are made good. And as a result of us being good, good things come out. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you so much for your love, your grace, your mercy. Thank you, God, that while we were your enemies, Christ died for us. And that while we were utterly opposed to everything that you are, Jesus steps in on the cross, takes on the punishment in our place, and makes us holy, righteous, and redeemed. There's not enough words throughout any human language to adequately express to you how grateful we should be for the sacrifice of our Savior, knowing that our eternity is secured only by what He has done for us. And Lord, I pray that our lives would reflect the faith that we have in Him. Lord, knowing that because He has made us holy, we can be holy to others. Lord, we can be good to others. We can speak encouragement. We can offer up prayer that is righteous. And God, that You would be honored and glorified through all these things working together. Lord, I pray that during this time together, You would help us to set aside any and all distractions, help us to worship You, help us to hear Your word proclaimed and preached tonight, help us to take it to heart and soul and mind, and help us to apply it. We thank You so much for giving us this opportunity to worship. And it's in Jesus' name I pray these things. Amen.
Amen. Good evening. Let's stand together. We're going to go ahead and have our offertory hymn, hymn number 143. We'll sing both verses of You Are My All in All.
You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking You as a precious jewel, Lord, to give up, I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is Your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is Your name. Taking my sin, my cross, my shame, rising again, I bless Your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, You pick me up. When I am dry, You fill my cup. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is Your name.
Dear Lord, I thank You for this day, and I thank You for letting us get this opportunity to come here and worship You, dear Lord. And I just ask that You would help Brother Tim as he brings the message, dear Lord, and You would just bless this offering. Thank you.
Before we continue in worship, just to let you know, ladies, I want the ladies to come down here at the piano, okay, right before Brother Tim preaches, so you can be getting ready. Any of those in the balcony who wants to come, I'm giving you time to be down here, okay, after we finish our last song. I see you peeking, Blair. I know you want to come sing, okay? We're going to sing 332, so y'all be ready, ladies, okay? All right, as we continue, we're going to sing 112, 164, and hymn number 93. You can remain seated.
Constant friend is he, his eyes.
such as me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. Whenever I am tempted, whenever clouds arise, when songs give place to sighing, when hope within me dies, I draw the closer to Him. From care He sets me free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. For His eye is on the sparrow, I know He watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For His eye is on the sparrow, and I know
ladies, come on down here, please.
ladies. Well, we're going to get into it a little more tonight in Revelation. Of course, you know it's so much in this chapter 4. We're not going to finish the whole thing tonight, but we'll just go for a while and then we'll. Revelation, chapter number 4, verses 1 through 4. A sight to behold. It's going to be quite interesting in this. This is the series about Jesus is coming. He's coming back again. And this is part 1, Revelation 4, 1 through 11. If you will, follow along with me as I read. Seen in heaven. After these things I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I had heard, like the sound of a trumpet, speaking with me, said, Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after these things. And immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne was standing in heaven, and one sitting on the throne. And he who was sitting was like a jasper stone and a sardius in appearance. And there was a rainbow around the throne, like an emerald. Around the throne were 24 thrones, and upon the thrones I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white garments and golden crowns on their heads. And out from the throne come flashes of lightning and sounds and peals of thunder. And there were seven lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. And before the throne there was something like a sea of glass, like crystal. Center and around the throne, four living creatures, full of eyes, in front and behind. The first creature was like a lion, and the second creature like a calf, and the third creature had a face like that of a man, and the fourth creature was like a flying eagle. And the fourth living creatures, each one of them having six wings, are full of eyes around and within, and day and night they do not cease to say, Holy, holy, holy. Is the Lord God the Almighty, who was and who is and who is to come. And when the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who sits on the throne, to him who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders will fall down before him who sits on the throne and will worship him who lives forever and ever, and will cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Worthy are you, O Lord and our God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and because of your will they exist and were created. Let's just bow for a prayer. Father, pray that you bless the reading of the word. And God, I pray, Lord, that help us stay on task, Lord, tonight as we try to share, encourage, but also help us to gain that understanding that you want us to have as we trudge through this book, Lord. We know it's a challenging book for us. We just pray you help us, Lord, to have our minds open, have a clear mind, open heart, and willing to try to be taught by you through the power of the Holy Spirit. God, we know you're able, you can. God, we just hope and pray that you will teach us and cultivate us and nourish each one of us, Lord, that not just about prophecy, but Lord, that we would know that it all points to Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. A sight to behold, Revelation chapter number 4, and verses 1 through verse number 11. Revelation chapter 4 is not only a new chapter in the book of Revelation, but it also brings us to an entirely new and different perspective. And so we're beginning to get into some of the meat of the book of Revelation now in this chapter. And the outline of the book of Revelation is found in chapter 1 in verse number 19, the whole outline, which it simply says, Write the things which you have seen and the things which are and the things which will take place after this. Now, we're going to go read a verse and try to explain what these different things mean. So, it says the things which you have seen. This is referring to John's vision of the glorified risen Christ back in the first chapter. The second division of the book, it refers to the things which are, it says. And so, that deals with the letters to the seven churches. And chapter number 2 and 3. But of all of the events which take place beginning in this chapter
are events of the future. We do not study Revelation to learn the future, find out what may happen. Yes, we have an interest in that. But there is an ulterior motive, and that is to learn more about Christ. These are events that are yet to unfold, and they are yet to take place. These are the things which will be placed after this. In other words, it's going to something is yet to come. And so that same Greek phrase here that's used for that words after this, in verse number 19 is also the same phrase used to introduce chapter 44 and verse number 1 after these things. So chapter number 4 through chapter number 22, it constitutes the most exhaustive panorama of prophecy that you will find in all of the Bible. And so this is the voice of God, or the voice of the Lord Jesus, which John first heard in chapter 1 and verse number 10. And then we find then an invitation. Jesus says to John, come up here. That passage there. And so up until this point, John, he had been seeing things from below. Now, Jesus wants him to see things from above. And so for the rest of this revelation, the book of Revelation, John will be seeing things from God's point of view as we move forward and moving forward. So I'd like to add that all of God's children, we need to see life from a heavenly perspective, not an earthly perspective. Sometimes you'll ask a person how they're doing, and well, sometimes you'll get an earful when you ask that, but they will respond, well, pretty well under the circumstances. We've probably been one of the ones that said that before, but I want to tell you the child of God is never under the circumstances. We are always over the circumstances. So if it's true, it is true that according to the last book of the Bible, the world is headed for trials and troubles and tribulation like we have never known before and never have seen in the history of mankind. But no child of God should ever fear, because in Psalm 46:1 it says, God is our refuge and God is our strength. He is a very present help in the time of trouble. That is a verse that we can claim tonight, because God don't lie. And so then there is an illustration for the Lord says to John in this passage. He said, I will show you the things which must take place after this. So the very first thing that John is shown is the throne room of heaven. Now you need to keep in mind that the focal point of the book of Revelation is the throne of God. And Revelation commences with the thrones. For you go back and you read in chapter number 1 and verse number 4, the seven spirits who are before his throne. Revelation concludes with a throne. In Revelation chapter 22 and verse number 3, it says the throne of God. 12 times in this chapter and 46 times in this book, God's throne is mentioned. And so immediately we are ushered into the control room of the universe where God is on his throne. And sometimes we think that everything in this universe, it revolves around the little planet that we live on called planet Earth. But I have news for all of us tonight. This universe revolves around the throne. And so if you want to understand the book of Revelation, remember this fact. God is on his throne, and God is in control. David said a long time ago, the Lord has established his throne in heaven, and his kingdom rules over all. That's why we say God is in control. Anybody ever ask you the question, how do you know God's in control? You tell them to read that verse, and that says God is in control. And so if you could walk into heaven tonight, if you could go into heaven right now, you'd probably see exactly what John saw as we're looking at here. Your mind and your thoughts and your attentions would be drawn to the same thing that John's was drawn to. That is the throne of God. You would see and you would experience some of those same things that John experienced. First of all, you would see the sovereign upon his throne. Immediately in verse 2, now here we go. Hang with me. Follow along in these verses. Verse number 2, immediately I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne set in heaven, and one sat on that throne. So the first thing that caught John's attention was not the pearly gates or the streets of gold. It was the throne of God, and more particularly, the God who sat upon that throne. And so, but also he's, as we look at God, what kind of a God is he? He is a mysterious God. John tries to describe God here, but yet he says that God was like jasper in verse number 3. It's hard to probably explain. I've always wondered, too, if a person's blind, born blind, how do you explain color to them? How do you explain something they never have been able to see? And so sometimes things are hard to explain, and so it was seemingly for John. For in Revelation 21, verse 11, it tells us that jasper was clear as crystal. Now, in ancient times, the jasper was an opaque stone, but here we're told that it's clear as crystal. And in other words, it was more like our modern-day diamond. This refers to the radiance and the brilliance of God. You wonder what jasper is referring to. That is talking about how the radiance and the brilliance of God. And so you know a diamond is a very valuable stone, a beautiful stone, because it's flawless and it's very character. There's no blemish. There's no blot. And so this refers to the beauty of our wonderful God. But he was like a sardius stone. And verse number 3, now this is a stone that's blood red in its color. And I believe this refers to the blood sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ. As we see in the Old Testament, the high priest, he would put on a breastplate here. And on the breastplate, there were 12 jewels. And the first jewel was a jasper stone. And the last jewel was a sardius stone. In Exodus chapter 28 and verse 17 through 20, you can go back and read that about what I just said. The Jews, they were God's people. And so the high priest was God's representative. And so these jewels, it was a reminder that God's people were always on God's heart. And so the high priest is the Lord Jesus Christ. This is God's way of telling us that even today, we're on his heart. God may never be on your mind, but you're never out of the mind of God. In Psalm 40, in chapter 40, in verse number 5, it says, your thoughts which are toward us cannot be recounted to you in order. If I would declare and speak of them, they are more than can be numbered. Oh, man, he's a mysterious God, but also he's a majestic God. When you think of something majestic, you're thinking of awesome. You're thinking of powerful. And so verse 3, we see there was a rainbow around the throne in appearance like an emerald. Now, this is a strange rainbow. First of all, when you look at a rainbow, you see a lot of times one end of the rainbow. And you look over, and then it goes down the ground the other side, and then you see the other end of the rainbow. This rainbow is a complete circle. It's not a half arc like you and I would see today, but it's rather a circle. Now, a circle is a perfect geometric figure. It has no ending, and it has no beginning. So I believe that this here, it represents the eternality of God, his absolute perfection. And so if you see, if you could put on a graph, there would be a straight line, because we have a beginning and we have an ending. But God would have to be a circle, because he has no ending, he has no beginning. And so I want you to also notice the rainbow is green like an emerald. Well, now in the Bible, green. Remember, green. And you need to know what these different colors of the Bible mean, just like you need to know what your name means. And there's a reason, there's numbers. There's a book that's out many, many years ago written, and it was talking about numbers in the Bible. If you are a mathematician, or if you're a person that loves numbers, you need to search out that book. It's an old book. And it's amazing how that, man, it's just like a whole new, it comes alive for you. And it talks about numbers and the meaning of those numbers. So, so green represents life. What it represents. And so when a tree or a plant is living, it's green. And so you need to remember as well that in the Bible, the rainbow is a symbol of God's covenant of faithfulness, a sign that God is true to his word. And so the first rainbow in the Bible, it was given to show that the storm was over. It is past. That first rainbow in the Bible was very important. But this rainbow here is a reminder. It's a sign to God's people that there is a God in heaven, that there will not be any more storms. There's no more pain. There will be no more sickness. There will be no more grief or guilt. There's only life everlasting, joy unspeakable. But you know, you think about the God that we serve. He is that magnificent. And from the throne proceeded lightning and thundering. And boy, voices. Verse number 5. Now, the rainbow not only signals here that the storm is over, but it also signals that one storm is just beginning. Lightning and thunder, they're signs that a storm is brewing. And these are storm signals. It's coming from the throne of God, and it tells us that the wrath and the judgment of God is yet to come on this sinful earth. Believe me, people think they got away with sin. They have not. The judgment of God will fall on this earth one day. And like ever before. The next several chapters in the book here of Revelation is taken up with what is known as the seven seals and seven trumpets, also the seven bowls of judgment. And so entire nations today, they will laugh and they will mock at the very existence of God. They believe that that they're in control of their own destiny by their power and by their might, and they have it all in control with their nation. But you know what? They don't realize what Isaiah chapter 40 and verse 15 and 17 says. You know, I see one of these dictators in these other countries and they're arrogant, how they act and how they treat people. Your mind will go to this in Isaiah 40 and verse 15 and 17. The nations are all a drop in a bucket and are counted as the small dust in the balance. All nations before him are as nothing, and they are counted by him less than nothing and worthless. Talking about how that he views those nations. This world has one more appointment it's going to keep with God, for God is going to have the last word. And so he's going to have the last say, according to Psalm chapter 2 and verse number 4. He's going to have the last laugh. When statesmen have had their last psaltery, and despots have made their last threat, when prophets are dumb with misgiving, and forces of conflict are set, when factions misleading and treacherous bring chaos where order prevails, when freedom long cherished is vanquished, and leaders long trusted have failed, when God and his word are derided, and men call it useless to pray, remember that God is still sovereign, and he has the last word to say. But then we see here also in the servants around the throne. Are you still with me, or have I put you to sleep? If you need to yawn, that's okay. It just makes it hard on me because I can't yawn. We have the servants around the throne. In verse number 4, around the throne, 24 thrones and the thrones, and we read that. And so now who are these elders? That surrounds the throne of God. Well, I believe that the best person to answer that is John himself. So, and he did, for we are told in Revelation 21, verse 12 through 14. That there are gates in heaven, and each one having the name of one of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel on that gate. And so we see that there are 12 foundations, and each one of them, they were the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. You see, God is a God of order, and there's reason. It's just not jumbled and thrown together. God, it's everything stands for something. And so, in other words, these 24 elders represents all of the saints of the Old Testament and the New Testament. And it represents those redeemed of the Old Testament. And those redeemed of the New Testament, they have died and gone on to be with the Lord. And sometimes there's misunderstanding among people as to how that people in the Old Testament were saved. I remember asking my pastor as a little boy that one time. And I remember what he told me. And so many people have asked me that as a pastor as well. Over the years, there's a misconception that people in the Old Testament were saved by the law. And when people in the New Testament were saved by grace, but that's totally untrue. Everybody who goes to heaven has to be saved, and everybody has to be saved the same way. You see, God's way of salvation has always been the same way, that is, by grace, through faith. And so as we look, they were looking toward the Savior coming in the Old Testament, and they believed. You had those that lived at the time of Jesus, and they believed, some didn't. And then we have us, all of us. He has been resurrected in heaven, and we have faith in his coming again. And so Dr. Harry Ironside, he was pastor of Moody Church in Chicago. If you ever go to Chicago, Illinois, I'll encourage you to stop by that church. It is a very historic church. And so he was a great Bible teacher. And so he was off on vacation one day, and he was visiting a Sunday school class. And the teacher there, he was listening to the Sunday school teacher, and they was talking about how people were saved in the Old Testament. And after a pause, the man said, the question was asked, how are people saved in the Old Testament? And one of the students said, well, by keeping the law. And the teacher said, well, that's right. Well, Dr. Ironside interrupted, he says, well, my Bible says that the deeds of the law shall no flesh be justified. And so then of course, the teacher said, well, and shook his head a little, and the teacher began to be a bit embarrassed. And so he said, well, does somebody else have an idea? Another student said, well, a person can be saved by bringing sacrifices to the Lord. And then, of course, the teacher said, oh, yeah, that's right. very obvious that this guy apparently was not very grounded in God's word. And so the teacher was trying to go on with a lesson, but Dr. Ironside interrupted once more. He said, "My Bible says that the blood of bulls and goats can't take away sin." And so by this time, this teacher, he was just getting a little unnerved. And so he said, "Well, you tell us how people were saved in the Old Testament." Dr. Ironside said they were saved the same way. We're saved now by grace. There were some who were saved by looking forward to Jesus. There were some who were saved, they were looking at Jesus and believed in what and who he was. And then, of course, we are told about those that are looking for Jesus. We're told these elders were clothed in white robes. That refers to their sanctification. But then we're also told they had crowns of gold on their head. Now, we need to let this sink in. This refers to their service. There are two words for crown in the Greek language. One refers to the crown of a king, and the other one refers to the wreath or a crown that would be given to an athlete that was victorious in what they were competing in. And so we're told in Revelation 1:6, that God has made us kings so we can receive crowns. God has made us priests so we can receive robes of righteousness. Revelation is very challenging. It's very difficult to understand at times. But there's a whole lot that we don't understand. But just, have you ever thought about it, how it would be like 5 minutes after you die? I'm talking about you as a believer. A person who's not a believer, but you as a believer, to think the absence of the body is to be present with the Lord. And just think of what we're going to be able to see. Oh, you just don't die and go and lay up the Lot Cemetery up here, and the spirit's still in there. When you die, if you're absent from the body, you're going to be present with the Lord Jesus. We're going to go into heaven. Speaking of this, we're coming to a close tonight in this section. This is part one I wanted to share with you tonight. You know, I've heard people deride and say things about those that have, quote, died and came back to life. My pastor, the deacon, he was on electrical pole. He worked for Mississippi Power, I guess it was. It knocked him off the light pole. Yet he just started to come to. He told me what he actually witnessed. He said, "I'm going to come back." He said, "It's one of the most pleasant places, the most peaceful place I've ever been." There's so many people I've pastored that have actually, quote, died. And so be careful that we don't dog out a person, because you don't know what they experienced. They may have had, because there's a lot of folks I've heard, some preachers especially, they will say, "Oh, now that's just it." Just you be careful that you don't. I mean, you don't know what they experienced. It was them, you know? And so the matter of the fact, we had a friend named Jerry May. Jerry had a really bad heart. He's passed it down. Going to be more. He's 60. He died about 3 years ago. He was 62. He passed. And this guy was, he was in the woods all the time. Never come to church. He didn't have to. Don't tell me about the church and don't tell me about God. You understand? That's the kind of person he was when he woke up to. And so I don't know what happened to Jerry over the years, but Jerry had this massive heart attack and they rushed him to the hospital. And it was the Widowmaker. Some of y'all know what that is. It's kind of a heart attack, I guess it was. And Jerry told me that he went, there was a gate. He went to this gate, and he said on the other side of it was the most pleasant, this bright light. And his mother and father, I knew both Clyde and his dad and his mother. And of course, I told you about his son. It was do in heaven? We're going to praise the Lord and cast our crowns at His feet. It's going to be a good time, I think. But to know that you don't have to go to hell, that's awesome. Just think about that. I think it's important that we tell our family that we love them. They try to lead us to the Lord. The hardest people in the world is your folks to try to tell about Jesus. It is. And we'll take up with their next time. Excuse me.
And I may see glimpses.